Roger that.
Welcome to our unrehearsed, spontaneous, and informal program. As always, no teleprompters, no cue cards, no idiot boards, no reruns. Just plain ad-lib conversation in which we try and tell it like it really is.
My question is, okay, you believe that Canadians should have unalienable rights like the French and the Americans?
Yeah, I don't like the fact that Section 1 of our Constitution really allows the courts to take away a lot of our what they call fundamental freedoms. I think that's one reason why we don't have the same vigorous freedoms that they do in the United States. There always has to be some flexibility. For example, I can think of some instances where we would restrict some freedoms in some extreme circumstances. But as we just discovered during the lockdown pandemic in Canada, it was way too easy for the government to
get any Tom, Dick, and Harry are married from the government.
Children, that's the last thing we want to do. We don't want to scare anybody.
Three, two, one.
Live from Ottawa, V&A presents, Take It Away, Vinny.
Good evening, North America. I'm Vinny D. I'm broadcasting tonight from Ottawa, Ontario. I'm doing the VNA's WDBG's Focus Scope tonight. I'm usually the broadcaster for it, sometimes my wife, but usually I am. Anyway, so what we're going to do tonight, we're going to talk about a myriad of things, a whole bunch of stuff that's been going on. You know, it's repeat. I'm going to repeat myself again even tonight because I'm getting damn tired of telling you people, did you watch what was going on there in the beginning with the Ezra Levant when I'm interviewing him there in front of the courthouse, what he said about unalienable rights? You know, I keep telling you people over and over about that, and you're probably saying, who's this boomer? Why should I listen to this guy? You know, because I've been around since Eisenhower days. I've seen it. I'm very well educated. You know, Canadians are, I hate to say it, but they're, you know, stuck on stupid. You buy them books, you can tell them a lot of them are stuck on stupid, not all of them. Some of them see some of the stuff and they feel it, but they don't understand the root of what's going on. Now, we're trying to tell you, we've been running and repeating ourselves, and you just don't seem to get it. Buy your books, send to your school, and you still walk out as dumb as you fucking were when you walked in. You know, what we're saying here is ever since 1776, the Canadian government's been trying to hide stuff from you people, okay? Whether it's your press, you know, bad-mouth the Americans, everything. In Canada, like Ezra said, you don't have unalienable rights. You know, the government can take away any of the rights that's listed in that thing at any time they choose. You only have those rights at their whim or at their discretion. You know, Canadians think they have rights because they've been duped into thinking they got the rights, but they don't have those rights, not really. You know, they only got the rights when the government feels like giving it to them. The government, the first section in that charter, what it says is the government's got a right to take away any one of those rights if they, you know, if they see fit. There's no really, really process defined in Article 1, Section 1, how they can take away them rights. There's a vague and ambiguous statement they could do this, but there's no way There's no clearly defined, you know, process or anything how it goes. We don't have free, we don't have elections where the people choose the senators here. So what happens when you can't choose the senators, when you can't choose the lower court judges? The powers that be, whether it's conservative or liberal, stacked. That's why Trudeau wanted to stay in power so long. You guys wonder how he's been in power so long, and he passes all this bullshit. It's because you guys can't elect your senators, you know. And so it gets to the Senate, and the people he puts in there just rubber stamp what he says, and it passes through. Come on, wake up, people. You know, we've been telling you this. And this is the problem, like Ezra's inferring to there. I kind of cornered him to get him to say that. You know, that isn't the whole interview there. It's just, you know, 5-10 minutes. I'm not cutting and pasting to hide anything. I'm cutting and pasting the most important parts out of it. You know, the rest was just basic, you know, just bullshit between me and him. But anyways, what I want to get into is these unalienable rights are so important. You don't have them in Canada. You think Poilievre wants, you know, they're going to keep wanting to appoint people for you. You know, you elect your MPs, but that doesn't put the power in your control or in your hands. You know, you elect the MPs, but you don't elect the person, you know, that's running the country, the party. It's a party system here. It's kind of backwards. It's a system the Americans and the French threw out, and they threw it out for a reason, for the same thing that you guys have been going through ever since the pandemic. That's why they threw it out. For every individual got a right to choose and just say no to this bullshit. But you guys aren't picking up on that. I'm not calling you stupid. I'm calling you, you're not thinking about it right. You know, this is what I'm saying, you know. I'm sitting here wearing my veteran's hat today, not to, you know, to glorify myself that I was a veteran, even though I was. That's not the point of it. I'm wearing it because it's just like a private little joke. I was on a search and rescue mission. I wanted me and my cameraman the other day looking for somebody that we think is missing, or we feel should be there more. So I was wearing this to make it look more official, you know, like I'm part of the Navy or something, you know, one of the veterans group, you know, up when I was up there at the Parliament asking him where my buddy was yesterday. We're getting to that one later. But right now, we're just going to carry on with this. I've told you umpteen times about this problem. And you guys are smart enough to understand what I'm saying. Okay, like you, Poilievre don't want to even go the full, you know, he says about putting power back in the hands of the people. The real way to do that is give you the right to vote for the lower court judges. Because if you vote for the lower court judges, by, you know, in the United States, they even appoint their Supreme Court judges. But they have a hearing about it and everything. Do you have a hearing to see about the judge? No, the people aren't involved in that. Even the representatives, they just say, well, you can be a judge. You know, they appoint them. And if you elected them, then by the time they got up to be ready to appoint him for the Supreme Court, you know, if you elected all the lower court judges, then by the time they got to the Supreme Court, the bad ones would be weeded out. You know, the people would already weed them out. But you hear what I just said there? The people would weed them out, not what's going on now. They just appoint any Tom, Dick, and Harry they want, you know, what, some party crony or something. It's both of them. Poilievre needs to amend the charter and the Constitution. You know, I'm not saying, like, be exactly like the Americans or be exactly like the French. But still, you know, tweak it to put the power back in the people's control. Just little things like I said, Article 1, Section 1, to clearly define that, how the rights, you know, can be infringed upon, you know, for the good of all. You know, it's, you know, who decides what. There's no clearly defined process. Anytime Dick and Harry can just claim that, you know, they're the government, so we can take away your rights. And that's exactly what happened in the pandemic, just like Ezra and I were saying there, that in that thing, if you saw that little clip again, I could play it again to show you, but right now you know what I'm talking about. I don't have to go, you know, go back and rewind that. You've got real evil people in the world, you know, like this clown. Everybody knows who this is, you know, Justin Trudeau, or this clown, Gretchen Whitmer, you know, you got that, and it's, you know, what the hell's Gretchen Whitmer there? Look at how ugly this girl looks, you know. She looks mean and ugly. You know, Trudeau just looks dumb, but she looks mean and ugly. Anyways, I'm going to get rid of her right now, put her back where she belongs, you know, out of the picture. And anyways, let's get on with this cast. You know, Gretchen Whitmer is one of Trudeau's friends. She copies everything that Trudeau does. She's like a puppet, pretty much, of the left, or the woke. And this hasn't happened. You know, the world just didn't wake up one day. It's been an ongoing process for decades and decades, and it's these failed radicals of the 60s that put their stuff in. There's a lot of casts that you can see in our earlier casts. I mean, there's a lot of videos in our earlier, in our, on our YouTube and our Rumble channels there that are talking about this. Glenn Beck talks about it. Andy Lee talks about it all the time on Twitter. But Andy Lee doesn't even get into how the process happened. You know, she's figuring you guys know that, and a lot of Canadians don't know that. It's been an ongoing process for decades. The left has been infiltrating all the institutions of Canada, the Society of Canada, especially the educational institutions. And what has become with their schools, they've become little leftist clone mass production plants. You know, the people go in there, and what when they come out, they go in there either raw or they were conservative, but all by the peer pressure and the professors cramming all this leftist commie bullshit down their throats. They come out of the place leftist, you know, woke leftists, and, you know, the history books they teach them is based on mostly Howard Zinn, Candy X's book. You know, it's all bullshit. It's not true history, you know. You know, they don't teach people about civics anymore in the lower schools. You know, women, their place are taken out. You know, the feminism has done a big deal. We have a thing about feminism in one of our casts earlier, too. I can point to it. I can leave a link at the end of this. Or anybody can call and find out. You know, because feminism has destroyed everything. It's unbalanced. Everything's been geared according to Mao's little red book. That's basically where all these leftists in 60s radicals, 70s radicals got all this bullshit. It was from Mao's little red book. And Mao said to destroy the four olds, you know, in society. One of them's history. That's why they tear down the statue. And the other one's the family and the church. They want to destroy anything that isn't the government. They want the government to reign supreme. And people don't realize how important this is, or adopting the tactics of the left, what I'm talking about here. You know, the voting, at the people actually electing senators and everything, that needs to be tweaked. And if you want to really do something for the country, demand that Polyev does this, you know, tweaks the Constitution a little bit, returns the power to the people. Because right now, he's just saying what you guys don't know, you know. He just knows what you guys don't like about Trudeau, so he's playing off on that. But what has he said about actually giving you the power and the rights? I'm not saying Polyev's a bad guy. I kind of like the little slut-off guy myself. You know, he's even helped me up the stairs with my cart before. You know, and there was no cameras on the guy when he done that. He just done it because he felt like helping. You know, and but he should do more than just run his mouth against Trudeau. He should say, I'm gonna return this country back to where it was and make it even better by giving you guys your rights the right way. You're going to have unalienable rights. Well, we got to prove that you don't have these rights. Right now, we got to prove that we do, and it shouldn't be that way. The onus should be on them to prove it. This is what I was talking about, Chad Arrows, and we got to get rid of all this government corruption and everything. And one way of doing it is that the people actually have more control, and the people say, no, no, I'm not going that. You ain't doing what we want. Get the fuck out of there, you know. And that's what elections are all about. I'm not saying turn this into a republic like the States or France. I'm just saying borrow a few things that will work to give the people rights. We can still keep the parliamentary system as long as the rights are balanced there and the elections are balanced. Right now, this appointment of their cronies, it's not helping out you people what you want to do. Okay, I'm not going to go in further for that. I'm going to take a little break for a minute. We're going to go a commercial break. And then when I come back, we'll be talking about some other issues. You know, I've got for your Detroit and Windsor people that we talk to all the time. You know, there's a couple newspapers or, you know, medias that's over there that's Gretchen Whitmer's pawns and the pawns of the left. They're frequently completely misaligned facts. And I'm not going to use that word misinformation, but what they do is they cut and paste what they want and they gear their story to make somebody look bad that doesn't deserve it at all, because they're all pieces of shit in my book. And, you know, they don't answer their phone when you want to talk to them. They're working from home because they got so lazy during the pandemic that they said, oh, I do that. They won't answer the phone. They want to screen stuff so they can hear only what they want to hear. It's all fucking bullshit. If they're media, they should take comments for anybody. That's what those open lines are supposed to be for, and those news tip lines. These pieces of shit don't even want to answer, and they run their mouth about bad, about people. You know, and I'm talking about some mainstream media here, too. It's not, I'm talking about some independent journalists, but they're left-orientated, and they're like, they're for this bitch right here. And I call her a bitch, because that's what she is. She's a no-good, you know, She's an old good friggin' idiot, this woman. And her attorney general's ripping off all people and everything. And they're trying to play like she isn't and saying, oh, it's a lie and everything. The facts are right there in front of what the woman done. You know, and then they got terrorists living in Dearborn. You know, my old lady put up a tweet about that the other night. One of my friends in Detroit went right to this terrorist house to show you guys. And they're calling him a left, I mean a far right, because he's complaining about some terrorists that could blow you up. Even a liberal, a left-wing person should be worried about them letting somebody in that's going to blow them up. This guy's a known terrorist on the terrorist list, and he's sitting there living right outside Detroit, Windsor, and here in, you know, in the other parts of the United States, there are Chinese that blew the border there, walked across over there, practicing with AKs. Now, what's that all about? You know, I don't know if Andy's looked in Canada, there isn't that many guns for them to practice with, but they're doing other things, you know, geared towards the destruction of the country. Some of the people that Trudeau let in, you know, and whatnot, they're not vetted right. Now, sure, I've done casts where I've seen immigrants, and some of them want to do right and everything. You know, I'd say a third of them, at least, want to do right. They don't got their hand out expecting the government to support them. They want to go to work and everything. And the other ones we should vet. The first question you ask is when they walk across the border is, what do you want to do for Canada? You know, and they got to stop doing, you know, hyphenating their identities. I'm a black Canadian, I'm black American, I'm so-and-so. Everybody just should be American or Canadian, you know, stop hyphenating. Because the hyphenation's all was started by the radicals in the 60s, too, to divide people. And like Roosevelt mentioned that a long time ago, we don't want no, you know, Teddy Roosevelt, not the other Roosevelt, not the one that was in World War II, but the old one, that the Rough Riders one, you know, walk softly and carry a big stick. He was saying that whenever you hyphenate an American or anybody, it divides people, and we should just look at what we are. Even like the media here was since 1776 in Canada been cutting down on the Americans, you know, and most of their articles are trying to make Canada look better. And there's more similarities than there are differences, and they want to play and make it look different that Canadians are somehow better. Believe me, even though they lie about, they say that Canada's social medicine system is better, in many aspects it isn't better. You know, on some things it's a little bit better. But for the taxes we pay for, it really isn't worth it. That's why they're coming to your senses and privatizing some stuff now. You know, it's just ridiculous, some of the things they do. There's got to be an equilibrium, a balance there, and they're not doing that. Okay, I'm not focused on exactly what I want to say in those issues, but after the break, you know, I'm going to come back and we're going to talk more. But till then, okay, Vinny, out till after the break. You guys think about what I just said, because it's so damn important. Thank you so much. Okay, I said that I was going to do some advertisement, but I changed my mind, you know, because it's going to be too long if I start putting in advertisements for hot dog joints and restaurants and some of the people that we like to advertise for, and I just want to get this message through tonight. So what we're going to do is I'm going to put up a couple of shorts by one of my friends in Detroit. He's going to say something pretty profound, kind of like I'm saying right now. Okay, all this stuff started to come into effect in the recent history after 9-1-1, but it's been going on for decades, and then I'm going to play a little clip by Glenn Beck right after that that's going to educate you guys on how it is. It's going to do what Andy hasn't been doing. She's been telling you about China, but she figures that you know, which most people should know. You know, anybody who's educated conservatively and actually went to a good school like Andy did, they would know this kind of stuff. She's just forgetting you guys don't know this. It's not her fault, because she just wants to stress what's going on today, and she does a damn good job of that. But we're going to go and show you how it happened. We're going to show you something from Charlie at first. Charlie Duff there, a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, a friend of mine out of Detroit. He's going to explain about 9-1-1, and then we're going to tell you how 9-1-1 occurred and what's going on now with all this hate and this bullshit and why it's going on. Then we're going to shut off the cast. It's going to be a short cast tonight, but let's get on with that. Here's Charlie.
I said the murder's only just begun. It's the beginning of the modern way of life. Your own government spies on you, ID every place. I can't get to Canada. They accomplished what they wanted to accomplish by flying those jets into those towers. Big Brother's all over you now. The world's at war with itself. That was the beginning. Don't forget. Never forget. Never forget the very substantial people that ran in there. Something that tall. It's on fire. Only to have a collapse on them. Then I profoundly understood what hate was and despair. I would go in and out of that hole. I was at 40 firemen's funerals, if it was one. I chronicled the firehouse. People were lashing out like Sikhs. You know, Sikhs aren't Muslims. And it was a kid, he got in some fight. I went to interview him because I had to, and he had taken off his turban and cut his hair, which is really religiously important to the Sikhs. And he did it because he didn't want to be seen as a Muslim. So he changed himself. And he said to me, "Bro, nobody hates Muslims more than us." And I said, "That ain't gonna get us where we need to go."
There is, Xi Jinping is now in San Francisco because we cleaned it up for him, you know, so it's nice. What is happening in our country is truly frightening. We're doing things that I've never seen in America ever before. And that's one of them. Xi Van Fleet is somebody who grew up in communist China. She lived through the horrors of the Cultural Revolution. She was a schoolgirl, and she was forced into the countryside along with other young Chinese for re-education after high school. She escaped communism, came to America. 30 years later, she sees the signs that are exactly the same as Mao's Marxist Cultural Revolution. She's just written a new book called Mao's America, A Survivor's Warning. Xi, welcome to the program.
Thank you so much for having me back.
Oh, you're welcome. I like talking to people who lived in communism or under dictators because they have completely clear eyes on what we are seeing today.
Yes. Yeah.
You say that wokeism is Maoism with American characteristics. What does that mean?
Yes, that's what I mean is that what you just said, that you've seen things happening here you've never seen before.
Yes.
It's because you, like many, many Americans, don't know what happened in China and what happened in Cultural Revolution. And we know because we lived through it. And that's exactly the same thing. Why I say Maoism with American characteristics, it's the same thing. The identity politics, cancel culture, weaponization of young people, indoctrination in school, all this happened in China and happened to me. And it's a little different here is that in China, Mao used class to divide people and divide people into red class and a black class. Basically, one is the enemy of the state and one is the ally of the government and the party. And here they use something different. They use race and then use gender. They use sexuality and it looked like it's different, but it's the same.
Well, this
and
is
indoctrination of children. It's exactly the same.
This is something that the communists learned in the 1960s when, honestly, the Beatles song Revolution came out and said, if you're walking around with posters of Chairman Mao, nobody's going to listen to you anyhow. And they realized that class would not do it in America. They had to do it based on race. But tell me about the four olds. I don't think most people understand this. And this, to me, shows how close it is to the Chinese Cultural Revolution.
Yes, that is Chinese-style cancel culture, and they are very specific. It is the old culture, old idea, old habits, and old custom. Those things are to be eradicated, to get rid of, to be destroyed, including statues, names of streets, names of stores, name of food labels, names of institutions, all have to be changed to be politically correct. Why they do that? Why they do cancel culture? Because they want to replace the tradition with something new. And in China, that is Maoism. And here is Maoism with American characteristics.
So Mao was much more open about what he was bringing in, wasn't he? I mean, here, yeah, they keep denying that any of this is happening. And it's all there. We can see it, but they deny it. Mao was open and saying this is what the new China will look like.
Yes. And that's the part that is very deceptive. Mao had power. What he was doing is to have absolute power. He was he feared that he was losing control of the party, but he was in control. So he can't be open about many, many things. But here, they have to hide their true intention. Since they use this very well, a very attractive slogans. And then a lot of people fall for it. And that is the problem with Marxism. It give you a beautiful picture of what it stands for. And people don't know, they fall for it. And I tell people, we fell for it too in China. And what we got? We got slavery. And we got really the absolute tyranny. And that's what's going to happen here. So people wake up, and how you wake up, not to find out yourself. If you find out yourself, that'd be too late. And I hope they are wise enough to hear from people like me who lived through it and then really learn from history. So, and that's what we don't have here.
People,
in this country.
Help us out with this, because I think Antifa, BLM, social justice warriors on the campus, et cetera, I think those are like the brown shirts or the red guards from China. But people will say, no, these are just honest people trying to X, Y, Z. What is the difference between BLM and Antifa and the social justice warriors and the red guards?
Yeah, no difference, because they're all indoctrinated to believe what they were told. And so Red Guards, you think they're just monsters? No, they were a lot of them from elite universities and middle schools, and they're from well-off families.
Yeah.
They were not monsters, but they turned into monsters because of indoctrination. The first killing that took place during the Cultural Revolution was done by a group of young girls in the most prestigious middle school in Beijing, and they were like 12 to 16. They beat and tortured and killed their principal, and there's no consequence. And after that, killing become commonplace. And then why they go after the teachers? Because they were told those in control and those in power were the ones want to take us back to the capitalism. And so for young kids, what are the people in power? They're teachers, they're principals. So they were the first one to be the target.
So here in America, you just said they weren't held and they paid no price for it. Here in America, our justice system has been completely dismantled. You know, defund the police, all of this stuff. Crime is on the rise. It doesn't seem like anybody's punished. If you're on the right side, you're not punished. In China, did they do the same thing? Did they dismantle the justice system and the police?
Yes, it's called smashing the justice system. The whole justice system, including police and the court, were dismantled. And so there's no consequence. No one can stop or dare to challenge the Red Guards. And that's the Chinese version of defund the police.
So, Xi, I've been talking about this coming for 2 decades almost now.
I know.
And it is now here. How much time do we have? What period is this like in China? How far away from losing it are we?
We are very, very close. Actually, we are losing. But I do think that there is a hope. And I, just 3 years ago, I was a quiet, shy Asian American. I don't share my opinion with people. Yeah, I was just quiet. I became a voice. And because I know if I don't speak up and stand out and to fight back, we're going to lose our country. And I do not want to live under communism again. During my speeches across the country, I met all sorts of people, parents just like me. 3 years ago, they were quiet, never pay attention to school board. They never got involved in local politics or any politics. I met so many of them. Now they are committed. Because they are waking up. They are committed and to fight to save this country. So that's our hope. That's exactly how we save this country. We have to be.
Did those people exist in China?
No. Because at that, no. If you wait by then, it's too late. Because those people don't exist. Because you can only find them in prison, in gulags, or in the graves.
Xi, I can't thank you enough. What do you think, just off on another subject, what do you think of President Xi's trip to San Francisco and how San Francisco cleaned itself up for that?
I know. I just tweeted out, and then they have people welcoming him with a Chinese flag, which to me, that is a murderer's flag. And I said, where are the social justice warrior protesters against the genocide by Xi Jinping of the Uyghurs, Muslims in China? Where are they?
They're not to be found.
They're not to be found.
To be found. Thank you so much, Xi. I appreciate it. Xi Van Fleet, the name of her book is Mao's America, A Survivor's Warning. She compares the Cultural Revolution to the Cultural Revolution here in America, to the Chinese one. And it is well worth a read and share with somebody that you know who maybe has a possibility of waking up. By the way, she was at the pro-Israel rally yesterday in D.C. So thank you so much. Xi Van Fleet, Mao's America.
Yourself into their slot. You know, don't friggin' idiot. I mean, they're friggin' idiots anyway. Let me get on with this now. Let's close out this cast. We're going to close. He's got nice pictures of Windsor, Detroit, some beautiful aerial photography. Look at him. Here's what we're saying. There'll be a word from the director at the end, too. All right, thank you so much, you guys, for tuning in tonight. Peace, and have a good evening. Stay tuned for our next cast.
Welcome, everyone, to the mesmerizing heart of WDBG. This new WDBG livestream TV channel virtual nirvana of news, commentary, and information. WDBG, we make every moment count. We delve into the depths of the unknown, tackle the toughest questions, and shatter the confines of what we know to be possible. So please click on the channel logo below to follow and subscribe.
Thank you for inviting us into your home. TV 50 hopes you've enjoyed our programs today, and as always, we appreciate your comments. Today's programs on WDBG mechanically reproduced.
I'm Amy WDBG TV. Please subscribe and hit my notification bell.